This said everything will change in the twinkling of an eye. You blink, and there's it varies, but anywhere from 1/30th to 1/300th to 1/3000th of a second. In the twinkling, in the blinking of an eye, everything will change.
Welcome to Cross the Bridge with David McGee. Let's join Pastor David now as he continues his verse-by-verse teaching of God's Word.
See, God knows everything. God is the know-it-all. I don't know it all. You don't know it all. But we can know him who does know it all. Amen? You might not know what tomorrow holds, but you can know who holds tomorrow. So you pray, you ask God, hey, God, tell me, let me know. And be careful of judging people by their appearance. I remember the story, guy goes in this church, he's got jeans on, and pastor says, well, you need to pray. Ask God what he wants you to wear when you come here. He said, okay. And he noticed everybody's looking at him weird, you know. He's gone a few weeks, comes back. He's in jeans again. Pastor comes up and he goes, well, I thought I asked you to pray about what God would have you to wear when you came here. He get, well, I did. I asked him what I should wear, and he said he'd never been here. You can't judge by appearance, gang. 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 7 says, but the Lord said to Samuel, don't judge by his appearance or height, for I've rejected him. The Lord doesn't see things the way you see them. People judge by outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. See, we judge by outward appearance, and because of that, our judgment is flawed. We can jump to hasty conclusions. I'm aware in ministry that as God continues to open more doors and with media opportunities, you know what, the battles are going to increase, and that's just part of it. There's always going to be people with snap judgments and people judging by outward appearance, but God looks at the heart. Remember, there was a fellow doing a service, and people lined up for prayer at the end of the service. He looked over, and there was a dude that was dressed in goth. He had eyeliner on, dressed all in black, and black earrings, and black attire, black eyeliner, black hair. And when the minister was looking at him, he just sensed darkness. Then he started praying, and he went up to the young man, and he said, yeah, I've been praying for you. I just want to pray for you, and, you know, what's going on in your life? And the young man said, you know, I've never actually shared this with anybody, but I think I'm supposed to share it with you. And I said, well, you know, he's ready for some big, dark confession. He said, well, go ahead, share with me. He goes, well, a couple years ago, I told God I would do anything to reach the kids I go to school with. And God said, anything? And I said, yes, anything. And he goes, I want you to become like one of them. I want you to dress like them. I want you to appear like them. Because these kids are infatuated with death, and I want you to speak salvation. I want you to share my love and my goodness with them. And he said, from that moment on, I began dressing like this. And I didn't tell anybody what I was doing or why I was doing it. You're the first person I told. The minister was humbled, and after that, he was praying. He said, God, I don't understand. When I was looking at him, there was just a sense, a discernment of darkness looking at him. And the Lord said, that was your heart, not that young man. Again, our judgment is flawed. Let's realize that. The Bible's filled with warnings about trusting by appearances or judging by appearances. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 and 6 says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he shall direct your path. We're told plain, don't lean on your own understanding. You will get to situations, life, and moments in time where if you lean to your own understanding, you will take the wrong path. Leaning on your own understanding, there's a Hebraic study saying it is like leaning on a sharp stick. It's going to hurt. The New Living Translation of that passage, Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not depend on your own understanding. Seek his will in all you do, and he will show you the path to take. So why is our judgment flawed? Now let's understand, God does give us discernment so we can look at situations, but always seek his face, seek his will, look into his word. And understand that God sees things differently than we see. And part of being a follower of Jesus is trying to see things the way God sees things. Now, that's a challenge, isn't it? Because he's God. He knows everything. We don't. I tell you what, caring for the lost is one way you can see things the way God sees them. Most of you know, I've always had a passion for lost people, a passion for people outside the church. Now, God is calling us, not just me, us, to reach them. So occasionally, I've missed service because I was, NRB or on television or doing this. And, God's opening the doors. And occasionally I'll get an email or staff will get a phone call. Where was he? What was he doing? Why is he not here every time? It's easier to be here. I live 6 minutes away. I'm to the point in life, travel used to be a lot of fun. Not so much anymore, There's people out there that are dying. And to me, it's hard to imagine that. And I know in one way it's a compliment, but it's really something myself and the staff struggle with. There's another assisting pastor up here sharing the same word of God with the same power and the same spirit of God. And then somebody says, my preference is to have Pastor David when Pastor David is out sharing the gospel so lost people won't go to hell. God tells me to go to Japan for 3 months. Sayonara. I got to do what God tells me to do. Amen? So again, what we see is flawed. What we think we know to a certain degree can be flawed. Now, we can trust the Word of God. We can trust the Spirit of God. But be careful about leaning into your own understanding. Because we look at, if you will, it's like we're looking through a cardboard box that has a little hole in it. And if, like there's a parade going through town and you're looking through that little hole in the cardboard box at the parade passing by. God's in a helicopter. He sees the whole thing. He sees the beginning. He sees the end. He sees the middle. He sees where it's going. We don't see like that. That's why we need him. That's why we shouldn't lean to our own understanding. We lean on him. We know in part and we prophesy in part. It's painful to admit we don't know everything in it. And all of us are wrong about something. You realize that? Now, I'm not talking about the essentials of the faith. When I'm discussing these things, there's certain things that you know that the Bible says that, man, you just have to deny Scripture in order if you want to go that route. I mean, to say there's other ways to heaven, you have to deny Scripture. Now, I understand somebody doesn't believe in the Bible, doesn't believe in Jesus saying that. I understand. They're confused. They're lost, okay? We call them lost because they don't know where they're going. I don't understand somebody that says they're a Christian that says there's other ways to heaven. Amen. Because you're calling Jesus a liar. Yeah. Yeah. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, the life. Nobody comes to the Father except through me. So I'm not talking about those main and plain things. But when we get to all these other doctrinal issues of whatever, the Holy Spirit we're talking about today, what to wear, what music, all this stuff, every one of us is wrong about something. The Bible says that when we go into heaven, we're all going to be changed, and we think of that in physical terms, and that is true, praise God. But do you understand all of our theology is going to change? All of our doctrine is going to change in some way? Life lesson here is each one of us is wrong about something. We don't know it all. Each one of us is wrong about something. We don't know it all. You would think as a people group that Christians would be more humble about their opinions, wouldn't you? I mean, because we understand there's a God of the universe that knows everything, and the more you learn, the more you realize you really don't know. I mean, what percentage of the knowledge of the universe do you think that you personally contain? If you're over 5%, you're arrogant, man. I mean, unless you're a pastor. I'm kidding. But, you know, one of the things that we need to do is we need to continue to always, and we say it over and over, reach and teach, reach and teach, reach and teach, reach and teach. Last year, we've had some changes. We've moved into a new building. We've had the name change, affiliation change. You know, but what has really changed? You know what? Nothing. We're still doing what we do. We still worship God. We still teach the Word. We're still reaching out to people who don't know Jesus. Reach and teach. You'll hear that a lot here. We reach out to people who don't know Jesus, and we teach the Word of God. Why do we do that? Because it's important. It's important to God. And we'll go through seasons where God will remind us of how important that is. Jesus in John chapter 9 says this, I must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. The night is coming when no one can work. There is a dark period, a dark time coming on this land. Jesus said, as long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. Now, this is an interesting passage because Jesus says, I got to do what I'm doing. There's a short window. That's Jesus said that. Guess what, friend? You have a short window. I don't know what your window is. Maybe it's 15 years. Maybe it's 73.2. I don't know. But Jesus, interesting, he said, well, as long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. Is Jesus walking around here physically anymore? No. Matthew chapter 5, verse 14, Jesus says, you are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. I've had a half a dozen people that visited this place from somewhere else that just immediately spiritually sensed that this church, this place, this building is a platform to reach the world. Amen. I mean, that's hallelujah, man. That's awesome. And what's interesting as time goes on, we're adding more and more channels, more and more stations. And it's starting to happen, starting to come to pass. We know in part. We prophesy in part. Verse 10 says, but when that which is perfect has come, then that which is in part will be done away. In the New Living Translation, it says, but when full understanding comes, these partial things will become useless. See, this further illuminates the prior verses. When full understanding comes, let me ask you a question. When will full understanding come to you or I? When the Bible was completely written? No. when we're in the presence of God. We'll have full understanding. Paul here is obviously talking about when we see Jesus face to face. It's interesting, I love old commentaries. I have some ones that are really, really old. And they're great, they're interesting, they're fascinating. It's really fascinating when I come across sometimes they say, you know, the prophecy's talking about Israel being in the land again, and they say, well, you know, we just know this is an allegory because they're never going to actually be there again. You think? They're there now. But what's interesting is commentaries before 1905, 1907, they don't take the slant on these verses that modern commentaries do. Why is that important? There was a place called Azusa Street where the Holy Spirit decided to show up. In power and might. And perhaps that is the latter rain that was discussed in the Hebrew Scriptures. And that which is perfect. Jesus is perfect. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 51, it says, "Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed." I told Mike that we really need that in the nursery. We won't take naps, but we'll change the diaper. But anyway, in verse 52 it says, "In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed." It's a very interesting verse for a lot of reasons. At some point, should the Lord tarry, I'm going to write a book about the seven feasts and how they fit into the prophetic time clock, because there's some really cool stuff there. But the trumpet is going to sound, and we're all going to be changed. You're going to be changed. I'm going to be changed. And part of what's going to be changed is physical, mental, and your theology. With the way my mind works, and I love to learn, I'm going to be excited to learn where I've messed up. You know, get there and go, "What? Seriously? Loud guitars weren't supposed to be part of worship? I don't get it. You said worship you with a loud noise. I took it literally." No, that's not me. That was just an example, okay? But we'll all be changed in a moment. You understand that day's coming? And every day that you live brings you closer to that day. Now, I don't know when that day is for you or when it is for me. But one thing I can guarantee is every day that you live brings you one day closer to that. Whether you're talking about your appointment or the second coming or the rapture. But friend, that's not something to shy away from. I'm not a doom and gloom kind of pastor. When we start talking about end time events, I'm not frightened, I'm excited. I've read the book. I know how it ends. And there's a passage in Revelation chapter 21, verse 4. It says, "And God shall wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away." That sounds like a good day. Amen? Amen. Praise God. Praise God. See, that's not something to shy away from. I don't mean go out and, you know, jump off a cliff or something so you can hasten that day. We all have stuff to do. When Jesus was speaking about end times events in Matthew chapter 24, verse 4, Jesus answered and said to them, "Take heed that no one deceives you, for many will come in my name, saying, 'I am the Christ,' and will deceive many." Now, that's an interesting verse in and of itself, because here's this itinerant minister, pastor, an unknown that never traveled that far, and he said, people are going to come over the ages pretending like they're me. Well, that's a pretty out there prediction if you think about it. But what has happened? Well, exactly that. And he goes on and he says, and you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you're not troubled. For all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and there will be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in various places. All these are the beginnings of sorrows. Reads like today's headlines, doesn't it? Nation against nation. There's more revolutions or civil war that happened in the last few months than I can ever remember. The devastating earthquake in Japan, the tsunami, the nuclear stuff going on. And now we've gone into Libya. It's going to be interesting because you need to realize that I love prophecy and I stay up on the news and read papers and headlines and website news and stuff. When we went into Iraq, Iraq had contracts for oil with China and Russia worth billions and billions of dollars. When we went in there with our allies, we went in there and decided those contracts were null and void and awarded those to the United Kingdom and to the United States. You can imagine that did not go over well in Russia and China. They have those same contracts with Iran. There's a 15-member Security Council in the United Nations. 10 of them voted to go into Libya. China and Russia abstained. We live in interesting times. We live in times that believers have prayed about and looked for. And we need to be ready. Matthew 24, chapter 24, verse 44 says, therefore, you also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect. Jesus tells in Matthew 24 about end times events. And in the next chapter, he tells about these bridegrooms and brides who aren't ready. In Matthew chapter 25, verse 13, it says, so you too must keep watch, for you do not know the day or hour of my return. You don't know, I don't know. But I can tell you what, when you realize that Jesus already fulfilled over 300 prophecies in the Hebrew Scriptures, the compound probabilities of that happening are staggering. Compound probabilities, if I said, okay, how many left-handed people are in here, that would be, you know, percentage. And if I said, okay, how many left-handed people who, you know, were born on a Tuesday, that's a smaller group. Left-handed people born on a Tuesday whose name begins with a T, that's a smaller group. Every time you introduce another probability, it reduces. And by the time you get through 300 of those, it's as if the entire state of North Carolina were covered 9 feet deep in silver dollars and a person blindfolded picked one out at the first try. And yet Jesus fulfilled 300 distinct and separate prophecies. Why do I say that? Well, if he's already fulfilled that many, he's got a pretty incredible track record, and he says he's coming back. Amen. Amen. And so we got to be ready. Now, some of you here, some of you listening, are thinking, okay, I'll get ready one day when I see things kind of starting to shake loose. I'll have some time. No, no, no. This said everything will change in the twinkling of an eye. You blink, and there's it varies, but anywhere from 1/30th to 1/300th to 1/3000th of a second. In the twinkling, in the blinking of an eye, everything will change. This can be your moment to ask God to forgive you, to begin using your time more wisely for the sake of the kingdom. I want to encourage you to pray this prayer with me, whether you're up front, still seated, or listening on television and radio and the internet, or in Greensboro. I want to encourage you to say this prayer out loud with me right now, asking God to forgive you. Pray with me now. Dear Jesus, I believe you died for me that I could be forgiven. I believe you were raised from the dead that I could have a new life. And Lord, I've done wrong things, and I'm sorry. I've not spent my time wisely, and I've done wrong. Please forgive me of all those things. Please give me your power to live for you, to be a kingdom builder and a world changer. In Jesus' name.
If you've prayed this prayer with Pastor David, he would love to hear from you and help you get off to a good start as a follower of Christ. We'd love to bless you with a new believer's kit, absolutely free. So please call us now or write to let us know. You've just made the greatest decision you'll ever make.
Congratulations to those people who just asked God to forgive them. Awesome decision. You know, I want to encourage you, as you hear these teachings, to apply them to your life. I've dedicated myself to help and share the truths of the Bible, to help you deal with life, and to discover the abundant life that Jesus talks about and offers to each and every one of you. I also want to invite you to get a free email devotional that I send out every day. Just go to crossthebridge.com, put in your email, and I'll send you an email every day to encourage you. Hey friend, I'd love for you to come join us here Sunday mornings at 10 o'clock. And also you can watch live stream Thursdays at 7 or Sunday mornings at 10 o'clock. Also check out the website at crossthebridge.com. Do you know and love people that don't know Jesus as their Savior? You know, I want to join with you in praying for these people. I've got hundreds of people that are committed to praying for them as well, for them to come to a saving knowledge of Jesus. Go to crossthebridge.com, put in their first names, and I'll be praying for them, and these hundreds of folks will be praying for those people to come to know Jesus. Take the time to do this. It's really important.
Who do you think gets to go to heaven?
Everyone.
Let's understand what this book has to say is that every person is going to wind up in one of two places. I know that you want to see your family and your friends saved because we've been forgiven of so much. We should desire that others would receive the same forgiveness.